3 days after a series of horrific explosions ripped through Sri Lanka, Islamic State has claimed responsibility for the bombings. As more details emerge about the terror attacks, Sri Lankan authorities have confirmed one of the suicide bombers involved previously studied in Australia. It comes as families have begun burying the 359 dead, including the Australian father who lost his wife and daughter.
A personal grief shared by many, a small community united in the grim task of burying a mother and daughter. Manik Suryarachi and 10-year-old Alexandria were killed at the St. Sebastian Church on Sunday. As their coffins were placed side by side in a cemetery near the family's village, a broken Sadesh Koloni, held together by family and friends, watched his wife and little girl laid to rest. An indescribable grief for a husband and father whose loved ones were taken by a brutal act of violence. Australian relatives just happened to be in Sri Lanka to visit the family.
I never thought that I will come to Sri Lanka to say goodbye to their bodies. It's very unbearable for the whole family.
And on such a sad day, this hopeful plea.
I kindly ask everyone to act as humans and not to kill anyone. We are all humans.
The nation's president inspected the devastation at the St. Sebastian Church in Negombo, where Manik and Alexandria were killed. But this was also a national day of mourning, a day when many buried their dead. Islamic State has now claimed responsibility, releasing a video claiming to show the attackers pledging allegiance to the terrorist group. New images have emerged of those suicide bombers, here two with backpacks in a lift at the Shangri-La Hotel before walking into the crowded breakfast buffet, and another calmly walking along the street and courtyard in Negombo before entering the church. And now there are claims by Sri Lanka's junior defence minister that one of the suicide bombers completed his postgraduate studies in Australia, raising concerns about the potential tentacles spread while he was there. The Prime Minister says they suspected two homegrown Islamic extremist groups had foreign links, warning more militants and explosives are still at large, among them Sri Lankans who've returned from fighting in Syria.
We are trying to apprehend them. People who are on the run. So far, we've been successful in apprehending many of them.
And again today, a controlled explosion. Police taking no chances with a suspicious moped parked near a cinema. And a theory for why Sri Lanka was targeted.
It's possible it could have been because of the Christchurch attacks. We cannot say yet.
New Zealand's Prime Minister played it down.
I have seen reports of those statements. We haven't received anything officially. Nor have we received any intelligence reports that corroborate what has been said in Sri Lanka.
But with numerous warnings ignored, the Sri Lankan president has announced a restructuring of the country's police, security and defence authorities, promising stern action.
And Nine's Asia correspondent Renee Henry is in Colombo. Renee, another explosion rang out just a short time ago.
Yes, with the firm belief that more bombers are still out there, this latest controlled detonation was on a bag left unattended at a restaurant just north of the capital. No word yet on whether it was actually a bomb. I'm told the moped that was detonated earlier wasn't. Authorities, though, simply aren't taking any chances. More than 60 people have now been arrested and are in custody, the government estimating that that number will rise to more than 100. Police remain on high alert for a lorry and a van believed to contain explosives and believed to still be in the Colombo area. One of the Australian women who were injured is due to fly back to Sydney this afternoon, where she's from. She is a 57-year-old mother. Her husband telling me that shrapnel cut through her mouth into the back of her neck, fracturing a vertebrae. She is in a stable condition, but desperate to get home for further treatment. Pete.